Good evening. I'm Margi Reeve, and I'm the Director of Publications at SCI-Arc, and I work with the students on producing the lecture series. I just have a couple of quick announcements before we begin tonight's program. The first thing is we have a new member of the SCI-Arc community who was born yesterday, and his name is Miller James Moss. So that's the first thing. Second thing is on Saturday, there's a conference here. It starts at 9:30, and it's about new prototypes and strategies for multi-unit housing. There are two parts of the program, and if you go to our website, you can read the schedule. It is going to be, I think, a really interesting day, so I encourage you to come. It's free and open to the public, like our lecture series. The other announcement I have is that there's a special lecture on Friday, next Friday, the 29th, at 7 o'clock, and that will be by Monica Ponce de Leon from Office DA in Cambridge, and she'll be talking about the firm's work in addition to discussing the vertical studio that she's going to offer here this summer. So Hernan Diaz Alonso is going to present Jeff Kipnis.
Hi. It's really a pleasure to have Jeff lecturing here in SCI-Arc. I spent the last two or three days trying to think how to define Jeff's work, and it's kind of difficult. So basically, let's go first with the formalities. He's actually the actual one of the curators in the Wessner Center for the Arts in Columbus, Ohio. He also teach in Ohio State. He has been teaching in Columbia University. SCI-Arc, also he's the author of many essays and articles published all over the place. Some of them have been critical and groundbreaking moments in terms of what we call today of the kind of cultural agenda. And 93 essay towards a new architecture in the folding in architecture issue. He also is the editor, author, depends how you want to look at it, about Coral Works, a collaboration work between Eisman and Jacques Derrida. He's also been writing critical work about Rehnkohlhaas, an interview with Herzog and de Meuron. But whatever the role that he chose to play, always his critical and influence in the contemporary discourse is also be done on one of the most important ones. So, trying to explain that, I remember when we were students of Jeff in New York a couple of years ago, one of my classmates, which is a German guy, still is a German guy, that he was trying to speak Spanish. He, after the classes, you know, Jeff is a bravo toro, which in English means he's a brave bull. But actually what he was trying to explain, and Jeff was a brave bullfighter, but I like the idea that Jeff was the bull. Because, you know, in bullfighting it's about this choreography between the bullfighter and the bull, and if the bull is the one who's pushing the performance and the bullfighter, and I think that was a good way to understand Jeff's work. And in Sevilla they have a museum about bullfighters. Actually it's more like a hall of fame, bullfighters. And they have only one bull in that Hall of Fame, which is El Malecón. It's a bull who killed three big bullfighters in a month. So I like to think that Jeff's work is like El Malecón. So please join me to welcome Jeff Kipnis.
Thank you, Hernan. It turns out that it's not the first time that the notion of bull has been related to my work. But I appreciate that take on it. It's kind of weird to be lecturing at SCI-Arc. I have a long history with the place. I taught for a little while in the first, I guess it was Nebraska, I can't really remember, which I was really trying to remember if it had running water. I was trying to describe it. I don't know how many of you have been around long enough, but It was a real question of whether you could actually wash your hands there, but you could get an incredible grilled cheese sandwich next door. So I met Carl Chu there, who's been a big influence on my life and my work, and worked with Andy Zago, who I know is now a guest here, became my partner, as did Bahram Sherdell, who was teaching here at the time, a really fine architect and a great architectural thinker, now working in Tehran. So it's like fun to come back here after so long. So I want to thank Hernan for asking me and say congratulations to Eric and all that sort of stuff. Despite the courtesy of having it referred to as a lecture by the poster, it's really just a talk. I'm going to try to talk through some ideas that have pretty much stayed identical for the last 2 years. So if you've heard my lecture in the last 2 years, I've changed a few jokes, but the contents are the same, and forgive me. Fortunately, I've noticed that students pass through quick enough that you could actually give the same lecture all your life in this field, and no one but the faculty know it. So I'm going to introduce you to some problems I think are interesting to me and how architecture and other media respond to it. I'm going to try to raise some questions for you. I don't really have answers yet to a lot of these things, but I try to find a way to summarize it all, and so I'm going to just show you a quick clip of a film which I think brings all of the issues to bear that I want to discuss tonight. So if I could just run the first video with sound for I'll start it and I'll kind of tell you where to stop. And if you could watch this, this is the main theme of the lecture. Blue is the main theme.
You don't need to follow anybody. You've got to think for yourselves. You're all individuals.
Yes, we're all individuals.
You're all different.
Yes, we are all different.
I'm not. You all got to work it out for yourselves.
So there's a lot at stake here. First of all, the really important problem that I was hoping to use this to identify is the conflict between the individual and the collective, which I think is a problem that has shaped our thinking and shaped architecture in a really profound way, and I'd like to look at some of that tonight. But beneath the individual and collective is the part-to-whole relationship. The individual to collective is, let's say, the political moment. It's the complex socialization of a much deeper philosophical problem, and that's the relationship of the part to the whole. There are reasons, I believe, to think that there's some new thinking about the part to whole relationship, which may obtain all the way to the question of the individual collective. So I'm going to try to trace that for you a little bit tonight. Now, the other thing that's important to me is that it's not just, I mean, you weren't actually looking at a piece of history, you were looking at a movie, a Monty Python movie. And so that raises the other question for me, and that's the material specificity. So this film does several things. It raises the question of the part, I mean, let's say the individual to collective. It makes a joke out of it. It's a film made 20 years ago, set 2,000 years ago. So it uses the capabilities of it as a medium to create a set of effects to situate a problem. And I'm going to try to follow that problem through different media. But it's really important because the other thing we want to know is not just what is the philosophical problem of the part to whole and how does that show up or as represented in architecture, but to what extent architecture and every medium in its own way or every material practice in its own way can offer a contribution to that reflection which is irreducible to any other medium. At one time, and for very good reasons, and in relationship in part to many of the people that work here on this problem, that problem was called the phenomenology of a discipline. In some sense, one tried to find its essential features. I've abandoned the idea of a phenomenology as a way to raise the question of material specificity and looked at this a new version of this called the irreducible effect. Essentially, what effects belong to a medium that cannot be paraphrased in another medium, but nevertheless, because one cannot define them essentially beforehand, they don't constitute a phenomenology. So, do you cut this blue off and I start slides, or okay? Is blue going to be here all night, or because it's only okay? That's good. Now let me ask you one more question. Can I move these over there? Okay, and then we can move them back for the second video. And I don't know if you recognize these. These are paintings by Gerhard Richter. And this is also, I think, a version of the problem of we are all individuals. Yes, we are all individuals. These are paintings by great persons that Richter admired. And they're set up, this is actually obviously not paintings. This is, in fact, a slide made from the catalog of a show. They're oftentimes installed in this grid pattern or sometimes in a horizontal line as they are currently shown at the Museum of Modern Art. But in a certain sense, the problem of are these individuals or are these all members of exactly the same? Are they same or are they different? In what sense what he's working through here, at least at first glance, and this is more like the image. And so the thing that this picture is not able to convey, however, is the quality of painting that makes this specifically not a matter of representing these faces as an illustration, which of course the slide then goes back and returns it back into. But a trick something I think I might have discovered, I'm not sure anyone else is, if you look at carefully at a portrait, at his own self-portrait, which is a blurred self-portrait and starts to be more explicit in its use of painterly effects, it looks to me it looks like Richter has inscribed himself in a certain way in the background. He's shaped all these portraits in a certain sense to reflect his own self-portrait in their positioning and their exaggeration of their features. And it makes, I think, the series incredibly profound, and it casts the whole problem of the relationship between the individual and collective in a different mood. Now, and I thought I'd show you that was really interesting, because I now would like also you to pay attention to the specificity of material effects, is when the catalog publishes these paintings, it puts these names and dates on the bottom of them, which in fact, of course, doesn't occur in the paintings, but when you see that, it absolutely restores the fact that you're looking at illustrations or you're looking at portrait photographs or something that's got nothing to do with paintings. And so that little bit effect of seeing the typesetting under the names essentially ends any possibility of capturing the sense of the painting. I thought that was interesting, but and clearly this version of the problem is very different than the Life of Brian version, the Monty Python version of the problem, but raises the same, at least the political version of the same issue. And to make the question even more interesting in terms of painterly effect, I wanted to call attention to this painting, which I think maybe Richter's, you can go see this show at the Museum of Modern Art. I think this may be his greatest achievement in painting. This is the funeral from the October. He did a suite of 18 paintings, some number of paintings about the October 18th killing of the Bader-Meinhof gang. And this is the funeral. But what's incredible about this painting, and of course that black thing down the middle is the gutter of a book, is that this is a painting of a crowd scene, but it's not as you study the painting, as you get closer and further away, the painterly effects that cause one to see a crowd are not drawings in paint of a crowd. And so all of the effects of that painting that are specific to make it a painting are really achieved by a kind of technique in the painting. So all those heads and what looks like, in fact, he drew carefully the photograph or painted the photograph and then blurred it, aren't true at all. They're basically abstracted gestures to create this sort of construction of a collective out of individuals, but in a single medium. Now, I mean, this is an old problem, and I thought, I'm sorry about the color plates. That's actually not David Smith, but the metal thing around the word color is a David Smith sculpture. And I think, for example, we can go back and take a look at how he's looking at this problem. This is a particularly interesting pose of his work because it's set against the architecture. And so these are the QB series. There is in David Smith's work an ambition to see how general forces collect, individuate, and then become specific, and can connect completely disparate material species. So the geometric elements, the cylinders and the rectangular parallel pipeds, assemble here provisionally as ideal elements into an architecture, produce a kind of provisional moment of architecture, and then become materially specific as their surfaces are hand-worked. But in the same ensemble becomes a figure, I mean, in a certain sense, a recollection of an anthropomorphic figure. And it's quite interesting to think that this is an argument that says we are made out of the same, in some way, the same forces of materiality and the same essential elements as the architecture. And so David Smith's work is already trying to reflect on these problems of individual to collective, but also part to whole relationship. I think the hand working of the surface is crucial because it essentially stops it from being simply reflective and gives it a kind of skin-like quality. The problem, I mean, it goes on and on and on. I thought it was very interesting to look at this piece by Jeff Koons, which is called a flower bubble. It's in Germany. I forgot where it is in Germany. The Daimler-Benz Plaza. Jeff Koons does something incredibly interesting. I mean, he takes these infantile figures, builds them out of reflective surfaces, and then we are reflected in them through them. And I mean, I don't know if I have the other slide, but let me see if I didn't. So whether it's an individual or us in the political environment, he is saying something quite interesting. The funny thing is, in order to get it, you have to remove all sense of irony, all sense of criticality. But there's this claim that a kind of adolescent individual completely dissolved into a direct reflection is the positive, affirmative state of the contemporary political subject. And I think it only gets its edge if you understand that he's not criticizing that, and he's not being ironic about it. He actually is affirming this work, which I think makes this work quite astonishing. So I'm just trying to review the way different media can take up the problem, stay within their own medium specificity, have their own art practices. One more thinking about the way mirroring is a way that we can take up. This is two mirrors by Gerhard Richter. This is the gray mirror. It's a pair of panes of glass painted so that the tane is gray, set so that when you stand in the middle of it to see yourself, you're not there. You're cut in half, and you cannot find yourself. But what you find yourself is completely absent in the field of all the people around you. You're not there. It's the radical condition of the annihilation of the individual in favor of the subject, or the suppression of the part in relationship to the whole. In the Museum of Modern Art show, which I think is really an incredible thing to see, as you walk across the threshold into the next room, you then meet the blood red mirror, and what you find yourself seeing is yourself absolutely reflected directly in the mirror, having just been cut in half by the gray mirror. So you're floating in the sea of blood and you see yourself. I don't know what that meant, but I kind of liked it. So I don't know why one would ever try to show pictures of mirrors in slides, but now the part to whole relationship has a long history in architecture. I thought it would be good to pick up sort of East Coast theory versus West Coast theory in honor of my being here tonight. This is a bit of West Coast theory by Morphosis. This is the 2468 house, I think that was called. And it has the feature of a lot of the work we're about to see, and that is exaggerating the part in relationship to the whole. So what becomes less and less interesting to architects is anything like the hegemony of the whole, or suppression, or balance, or harmony, or any way from either modernism or classicism or any of the arguments that would have put the part subordinate to the whole. Work is now in this period being done, which actually makes the part so much more important than the whole, than in some sense the whole in some cases dissolves. This is a really, in the first instance, he's using a semantic element of architecture, the window, and the house is all about these four really weird windows. He then, in the Sixth Street house, or Tom in this case, in the Sixth Street house, does something completely different. He pulls in elements that have nothing to do with the architecture whatsoever. These are 11 found objects that are going to become the most important feature in the Sixth Street house, and the whole house is going to be built around these objects, which aren't even related to particularly to architectural elements. And that launched the series of spectacular drawing inventions by Tom Main and Andrew Zago, which are currently on exhibit at in SF MoMA, a show called A Perfect Acts of Architecture. But this work exemplifies an exploration by architects to foreground the problem of the part to the whole, not yet politically taking up the question, I think, of the individual to the collective. And again, on the East Coast, Peter's doing the same thing. He's working with some syntactic elements of the house, and you can see, for example, if you see the red and green staircase, or basically all the parts in this building are more important than the whole building, even if he's trying to hold it together in a kind of syntactic logic. So the green staircase and the red staircase, the green works and the red doesn't. The part-to-whole relationship in this order of research, which is, say, now 30 years ago, is indicative of a whole tendency in the 20th century to look at reassembles at collages and reassemblies for their capacity to produce new knowledge through disjunction. I call this in general collage, but collage is nothing other than the celebration of the priority of the part to the whole, and the priority in some sense of the individual to the collective. Even if all collages have a compositional order, all collages are really looking at the capacity of the part and the disjunction of parts to produce an effect that the whole really stands behind. And this is an extraordinary piece. One thing we have to notice is that in collages and in general in favoring the part, you actually suppress the material specificity of the elements. We don't really care about the structure, the performance, the function, the quality of the material effects of the wheel and the relationship to the stool. What we care about, in some sense, is the signification that's produced in the disjunction or the production of meaning. And by decontextualizing and deterritorializing the parts so as to exaggerate those. But you don't see the whole bicycle, you don't know how it runs, you don't get to sit in the chair, another body of meaning is lost. This is also, I think, a collage, and it has exactly the same effect. And I'm not saying that negatively. This was an incredible achievement, but this is also conditioned, as is all analytic thinking that produced scientific thought parallel to its development in artistic thought, that decided that essentially analysis is an argument that one can break everything down to its parts and learn as much as you can about it by studying its parts and their relationship as they assemble into wholes. And that's essentially what this is. You break, what's being studied here is the smoke and the lung, and there's a convenient vehicle for the lung, and that's that little rat. And so the deterritorialization contextualization of the part in this kind of, in a collage is met and paralleled with as an achievement by scientific analysis and the assumption that, and it's sort of the Newtonian assumption, that all problems can be broken down to their elements and studied. Now, architecture, it's not always about work that shows part-to-whole relationships. Sometimes a highly sensitive attention to just the individual or to the local condition produces, I think, an effect that may not actually be the subject of the architecture. This beautiful drawing by John Haydick. I mean, for me, this is me, but when I see this drawing by John, I really cannot see this column with rebar any the same. I mean, it has a new kind of poetry for me that never goes away. So it's not that John is doing that in the work, but the work has the effect by being deeply attentive to the to its individuality and specificity. This is the house of the suicide, and again, once I saw that, this formwork for a new piece of construction couldn't be the same for me. And so it was not just necessarily about making this issue of the philosophy, the part to whole relationship to the work, but there was these reframing effects that architecture could produce. Now, the work developed and reached a kind of, I think, it reached a level of sophistication in architecture in which all of the techniques, the whole techniques, the reflections on collage, reflections on the status of typology, reached the most sophisticated moment, I think, maybe 10 years ago. And the two examples I'm going to show are really a debate between two architects, really great architects, I think, on that problem at the political level. This is the Villa de Lava house. I know you know this. It is a collage of three buildings, Villa Savoie, the Mies van der Rohe Farnsworth House, and the Philip Johnson Glass House. And it works out a problem in collage of the atomization of the family unit, in this case the collective, into individuals that are only provisionally assembled as a family. So the mother has her bedroom, which is close to me. The father has his bedroom, which is the far thing hanging out. And the daughter has her bedroom, which is the bar of windows on the right side. When they meet at all, they meet collectively in this little little glass house pavilion to the garden. And so techniques of collage, techniques of part-to-whole relationships are brought to bear on a reflection in architecture of the status of the nuclear family and the priority of the individual to the collective. There's a lot more to this house than that, but I let's see, can I make this go forward? I think it's really important to remember the role of Le Corbusier in this particular project. And I mean, the other two houses are important, but I think because of the comparison, there's the room, there's other things that are going on. For example, is a classic debate about the Miesian corner versus Johnson corner, Johnson's closed box corner versus Mies's cantilever corner, is resolved by Rem by using a sliding glass. So when it's closed, it's the Johnson corner, and when it's open, it's the Mies corner. And what he's actually introducing is another argument, this argument that through, by not seeing architecture as a set of static elements, but as a set of dynamic elements, problems that were considered antithetical essentially dissolve once you allow things to move, once you allow elevators, escalators, people to move through the project, projects to be conceived in terms of dynamics, classical problems dissolve. So, but I mean, it was just a side issue. The status of the priority of the part is everywhere indicated. For example, in the excessive structuring and irrational geometry of the columns for that cantilever, and if you remember, the other cantilevered box is completely without any columns whatsoever. So there's nothing there that's subordinate to any higher logic of the whole. Everything is there is working as a kind of radical assertion of its own parthood in support of the argument about the individual, about the status of the family as provisional collections of individuals. Really profound piece. I mean, architecture for me at its profoundest in its sense of taking an ambition that's specific, materially specific, that draws on the history of architecture, that works in terms of the typology, and drives it to where we're reflecting in the most intriguing levels about it's the way architecture shapes our lives. This is the Miller House by José Ubrí, built almost exactly the same time, far less known, exactly the same argument, also drawing on a Le Corbusier building. But the way he draws this argument, and in some sense I prefer this, he's drawing his reference from the mill owner's house, also by Le Corbusier, although from 30 years later, built in Ahmedabad, India. And what José does is essentially builds the concrete, I'm sorry, these are out of order, so I have to go back. He builds a concrete frame, a kind of urban concrete frame, and then those white boxes are the individual apartments, one for the mother, one for the father, and one for the son, and each with their own entry and exit. So they're essentially floating in an urban frame in the middle of a suburban site in Kentucky. And so the structure, there's not, the collage is not, there's no collage working at here in the sense that Rem did it as a quotation of important iconic buildings. What there is a collage of organizational types embedded in a kind of sea of concrete to support it. Now when they meet in this interior space, and you can see all the individual entries and ramps that take them down, and there's a kind of notation of outside and inside. Anyway, this was a kind of summary of, so those are two of the, that's the mother's apartment and the father's apartment, which I think has a secret door connecting them. Now, I want to be careful, this is very short, this has got nothing to do with much of anything, but I want to be careful to not be saying to you that I think all architects have to be researching important philosophical problems, stating their social and political condition, and trying to figure out how their work inflects that. I don't think that's the case at all. I think most architects that are working, they work on problems that are smaller, more detailed, and as those problems evolve, then they stimulate in that architect or in other architects these larger organizational issues. This is, a great episode from the Farnsworth House, and I think these two projects are really reflecting on this episode, not yet taking up a kind of philosophical discourse. But this is the Shigeru Ban House, which I think is, draws very heavily on the Mises, but it also is, for example, the problem. If you look at the thickness of the element of the column, the capacity to thin that column that much to where it's almost gone is essentially the research of this, and it's made possible by the fact that the back of the house is attached to a mountain, so that there's no transfer load. There's no horizontal load, so it can get the member as thin as possible simply to take care of the vertical load. But he's also introducing this curved element to see how that modulates the space, which is exactly the same problem that Preston is trying to experiment with in another way. So these are not, I'm basically saying that the kinds of researches that interest me are not always when they reach the level of this reflection, but I think the apotheosis of it is when they transform our thinking about how we live and how we relate to one another. I've mentioned earlier the problem of materiality. I'm now going to introduce what I think are some ways that the part-to-whole relationship might be seeing a new form of thought, and then I'll close with, generally what happens is I try to give a slightly interesting view of architecture, a suggestively vague allusion to new science and philosophy that may be very profound, and then a series of unbelievably trivial applications by me and other people about how they work. So that's how that's the shape of the lecture. So this is, this slide deeply moves me and troubles me. What this slide is, most of you know, is atoms that have been lined up to spell IBM, which means, it indicates two things. A really profound power over matter, which suggests that we were going to be able to do unbelievable things in the future, and no idea what to do with it. So we just line it up and make a little neon sign out of it, which I think is pretty amazing. That is, I think, both the essence, and even though it's not a collage, that's the essence. Those things are deterritorialized, and they're atoms taken out of their context, and they're no longer behaving as atoms. They're simply interesting because they can show up as a blue blip and make a sign. This is also something that was done with the same scanning tunneling electron microscope, but these atoms have been joined into a molecule and they start to perform new behaviors. And in fact, the color in this slide is an emergent property. It's once these atoms join and start to communicate with each other into a molecule becomes slightly more complex, something new happens, and what's interesting is that what new thing that happens cannot be predicted from the properties of the parts. So the behavior of this molecule in some sense is irreducible to its part, and that's the thing I want to study a little bit now, and then we'll go home. This is upside down, but it won't matter. This is really what this is a game. You take a bunch of buttons and you put them on the table. Take 20 buttons on the table, then you pick up a button, put a string on it, and tie it to another button. Pick up two buttons, and then you put that down. Then you pick up a button, pick up two buttons, and tie them together with a string, and you put that down. And essentially, the question is, what is the behavior of that problem? This was a major problem studied in mathematics in the 60s. And something really interesting happened. If the numbers of buttons and numbers of strings are large enough, you get the following behavior. For a long time, the average size of the buttons, the button you pick up is usually small. At a certain point where you've tied enough, a completely new behavior happens, and the size of the cluster of the button goes up dramatically. But what's important is that this zone is roughly the same, and this zone is roughly the same. This transitional condition is a phase shift. So something completely new is happening. And the behavior here is an emergent behavior. The size of the cluster, it's not so hard to figure out. After you do it enough times, the one cluster takes over, and instead of picking it up and being two, it's like all 50 or all 100. And then, so every time you pick it up, you pick up this big cluster. But what, from my point of view, and why complexity theorists are interested in this is a behavior that cannot be reduced to the parts of this behavior. The parts and whole relationship here cannot be analyzed back to buttons and threads here. So this phase transition indicates a completely new behavior, a complex, it's not yet an adaptive network, but it's a complex network, and it has emergent properties. And in this instance, it's really important for us not to use this idea of emergent properties as some kind of vague indication. It's specific. You can measure it, you can see it. It doesn't belong to the parts. It cannot be predicted from the buttons and the threads. I'm now going to show you a slightly more complex version of this, and try to use it to introduce the kind of closing conclusions. So if I could cut this off. The system here is cut this light off. But before we turn that on, make sure there is no sound, because there's music to this that I can't stand. So what we're about to watch is a version of the buttons and thread game, except this is now done with birds. And these are the river phoenixes of Madagascar. And you're going to watch emergent behavior as the numbers increase and the communications between the elements increase. The numbers are the numbers of birds. The communications are the birds relate to each other in some sense like the strings. But as the numbers increase and the amount of communication increases, you see three emergent behaviors totally unpredictable from the prior one. The other influences are the lights going down. So it's stimulated. So there's a reason that they're starting to do this. Sun is setting. It's an adaptive behavior. So in fact, it's a evolutionarily adaptive behavior. But I think the more interesting thing is to watch the emergence occurring. So if we could run this tape. So these are the river phoenixes of Madagascar. I went down there. It was really hard to take these shots. So in the daytime, not river phoenix. He was a guy. These are the river martens. Sorry, these are river martens. Yeah. So in daylight, they stay either they hunt individually or in small clusters. Their behavior is totally disorganized. They imitate, because they're all feeding, they look like they're imitative, but they statistically show no organizational behavior. And this is called this is actually called a random pattern. Now, pretty soon, as the light goes down, they start to form larger clusters. And the larger clusters already show a first level of emergent behavior. They're slightly more organized, but they're now in a thermodynamic pattern in the sense that they're statistically thicker in the middle and more edges. But as they start to collide with other clusters, they then reorganize into a third emergent behavior, and that's a flock behavior. And once that happens, an entirely new organism is occurring, which even though it's made of these as parts, the behavior cannot be reduced to, you cannot understand the behavior you're about to see by understanding the behavior of these individuals. So in some sense, it's irreducible and materially specific, but it only comes from the fact that a large number of parts is set into a high level of communication. There's no self-conscious intentionality operating at this point. It's no criticality. The behavior simply emerges from the complex adaptive system. So I'll let you watch it and see if you see a change in the behavior. And I think at this point the narrator says, and as the sun sets, the birds fly off into the dark for the night, I think. So I what's interesting for me is, like the buttons, this is a deeply dramatic change in organizational behavior that's not about a kind of critical self-consciousness on the parts, and in some sense you can't reduce it to the parts. It's one thing. Okay, thanks. Now, I'm interested, what research do we conduct to try to take advantage of how architecture can explore complex adaptive emergent behaviors that come from the properties, simple properties of complex adaptive networks. And those properties are really these. It has to have more and more and more parts that are finer. And these parts have to find increasing mechanisms to communicate with one another. The parts have to be more, therefore smaller. They have to be mobile. And of course, what it is to mobilize parts in a static system like architecture is hard to imagine. And they have to begin to form a way of communicating with one another. And in fact, one of the great ways to think about emergent behaviors is to think about the problem of the architecture of the body. The architecture of the body is not, as you imagine it, five systems, the skeletal system, the muscle system, or however many systems, the organic system, the muscle system, the circulatory system. That's in fact the outcome of the developmental architecture of the body, which in fact starts with one cell, divides, you know the process. And the reason it's important to distinguish between the two is because it's through the process of cell division and multiplication that a huge number of parts can stay mobile in an intense and dynamic communication with one another, even as they specify into tissues, which is why mind is now considered to be, the idea of complex adaptive networks producing emergent behavior shows the most promise for giving an explanation to the production of mind. So, last few slides. Now, I think I'm interested in the problem how does an architect work to take up this problem? Because it's not about building in a text of complexity into the work. It's about trying to find a way to work so that your processes and your manipulations are more intimate. And the example, if we had the time, I should have and could have gone through examples of REM and other Preston and Frank or whatever. This is a particularly interesting project to me because it's a collaboration between Fabian Marcaccio and Greg Lynn called The Predator. I'm not here to tell you about whether Greg's work is great or not, or Fabian's work or not, great or not. It's not about form. It's not about, blobs. It's simply about thinking about the way an architect is doing research with the materials in such a way as to get them to be more highly mobilized, finer, more intricate in their connections, and see if emergent behaviors can occur. And it was particularly important that I thought he worked with Fabian Marcaccio. Fabian is a really interesting painter. To get some sense of the scale of these paintings, I mean, that's a person. Fabian works digitally at full scale, so when he does one of these digital paintings on his computer, the image on the size of the computer is not scaled down. It's exactly the number of square inches on the computer screen as it is on the painting. And, so you could imagine the level of detail he's able to get. So as you get closer and closer and closer to the painting, there's no fading away of detail. I hope you notice the image construction in the upper left as also drawing heavily from Richter's construction of the crowd image. It's a technique Fabian borrowed from Richter in painterly construction. It's very similar from the way, let's say, Korb influenced José and Rem. And as you get closer and closer to the paintings, they don't dissolve into parts. They increasingly become more detailed. And he adds plastics material, paint added to the digital images. And so there's a movement from the image construction to the picture construction to the painting construction. So it's highly intricate. You're now looking at, inside those little bitty squares is about an eighth of a square inch. So that's the level of detail that that large painting you saw. And so it never falls away into parts. What he did, now, he, in his work, he's interested also, as every painter is, in the history of certain painterly effects. For example, if you look at the surfaces and the optics of this, he's used the optical quality of an image, and there's the applied plastic, then there's, here, I have a laser. This is a paint stroke constructed that's applied to the painting. This is the same effect in the digital construction, and then these light effects, which are in the digital image, are then recapitulated as best he can by painting something like a glaze on a painting. So the entire apparatus is to reflect on the production of painterly effects at every scale. Greg produced one of Greg's works. He sent it to Fabian. Fabian mapped it out, so there was a full-scale painting. Now, the thing I think that was interesting is, I assume you know Greg's work, so I didn't show you all the blob production, but the important thing is, and for Greg, is to get the architecture to get in dialogue with Fabian's painting. It couldn't be about making a form. It had to be about making every element of the process work at the same scale in a dialogue with a painting. So the milling artifact, the little track of the milling, became an element that became possible for him to use. And also, he would do the digital modeling of the landscape surfacing, which you see. Now, these are correlated by Greg with the painting. So the idea would be to not make a blob, but to make a structural skin, a painting, that behaved like architecture in the sense that it was able to enclose space, but that all of the effects of it had nothing to do with the form, but had to do with the behavior of a skin from outside all the way through to the inside, and to try to get every architectural effect or every artifact of the production of the architect to work in close dialogue with every painterly effect. And so the process is he milled out the element, they vacuformed an eighth inch plastic, and then they had to go back over and vacuum form Fabian's painting, which was printed on 32nd inch plastic on top of the 8th inch plastic, so it's actually a two-layer system. And then when it was constructed, Fabian and Greg went back in and did some handwork to get the effects to move through it. I'll try to show you this. I was trying to be careful tonight. I hope I never show you the whole form, because I'm not trying to. It's not about the form. It's really about this detailed production of effects, which comes in my mind from trying to find architectural ways to work in much finer scales and to mobilize the communication between the elements of the process. So this is what a panel looks like, and so you can see that the milling effect, working of the form at the scale of the skin rather than at the scale of the form, is working with the optical effects in the painting, so that the light is there four times. It's in the painting, it's on the surface, it's reflected in the edges, and then it's on the painting again as paint. I'll try to show you that more specifically there. So you can see the printing moving into the architecture, then the plastic, then paint added on top of that, and then that's folded back through the skin. So the entire operation is operating at the thickness of the skin, which becomes structural. It's only a blob in the sense of the habit of seeing it as a blob form. All of the research, however, is at this level of the detail. So it was an example of, for me, of not taking up the problem of the individual and collected as it's being revised by this notion of emergence in complex adaptive networks, but simply changing the way one works with the specificity of the material to see if new effects could be, if emergent effects could be generated. Now, I'm a curator, and so I do shows. Now, shows are constructions of theater and social spaces, I think. They're mostly these days, I don't know why, I guess it's a kind of puritanical thing. We like to be, basically, we like our exhibitions to be, pedagogical would be the nice word for it, but pedantic. We like to walk in a museum and have it kind of teach us to death. I like that. I mean, I like informative exhibitions, but the social space of a theater, I mean, the social space of a museum is an opportunity for a whole other effects. And so I did this Mood River with a colleague, Annette Massey, and it's really a design show, and I'm gonna go through it and, you know, show you, it's really a sort of celebration of the relationship between contemporary art and design over every kind of, but the whole time I was trying to think of, could I make use of these ideas of higher levels of connectivity to produce emergent effects. The effects, emergent effects, are oftentimes, for example, affective and not performative. It's as you watch the birds, the two things that would have interested me is not only your understanding of the behavior, the emergent behavior of the birds, but your response, your relationship to watching that. I mean, I find it awe-inspiring. I mean, incredibly beautiful. And for those of you that are working on Maya-based projects, if you understood that Maya was actually trying to imitate those calculations, Maya is actually a construction of surfaces exactly like that, that you actually could probably do a better job in understanding the way to produce emergent effects. But so all I'm about to show you is Mood River. It's a dumb show in the Wexner Center. You're welcome to come see it. But behind it is my effort to think about the production of emergent effects by using these two systems, mobilizing the elements, increasing their levels of communication. Now, here, the principle of Mood River, this is a Reynolds diagram, it's a flow diagram, you don't need to know much about it, but it was what we were going to base the entire exhibition on. And basically, the idea was, this thing was interesting to me because one flow that changed by cause of change of forces went all the way from being basically minimal to basically voluptuous or blobby in one flow. And so this coherent material system produced changes in form and mood, and we were going to map everything on this river diagram to make the show. I know it's a dumb idea, but we did it for 2 years, and we knew we were onto something when we found a toothbrush that actually had the Mood River diagram all the way in it. So these are the pleasures of being a curator. So our first thing to do is to try this. I mean, we basically just set the diagram out, gave it various titles of, you know, what its affective dimensions was, serene, voluptuous, sinuous. We started to map bliss, trauma, ecstasy, rage. And then we saw, could we line products up so that they would move along this diagram and show the evolution of these forms and surfaces and materials, because in fact, we believe this to be a mapping of the way a very limited numbers of materials and a very limited repertoire of manufacturing techniques actually were behind almost all material production. So a high level of coherence should have been expected, which was not attributable to something mystical like the zeitgeist, but was a direct effect of the way the complex networks of material production. And then we started to look for emergence and, you know, organizations of sensibilities, and you know, there was the stealth geometry effect where all these products were drawing from the quality of this geometry, and et cetera. And then we went out and got a bunch of stuff, and these are the galleries. David, are you here? Wait, if not, this is David Erdman and Servo's piece. This is the Bliss Gallery. This is a fiber optics chair that, so everything kind of looks flowy. Now, this is the coral reef of taillights, and above that is the school of fish of household implements. And so you see, you start to see surprising connections between completely unlikely elements, but the affect, this organization, when you're in there, what's happening is, I believe when you're in this installation, the production of affect in the installation is coming from the high level of communication among the elements and the large number of elements. So, and as you're in there, things that have nothing to do with each other, toothbrushes and all the way up to vacuum cleaners, and every, you know, there's 1,110 things hanging here, all organized on that diagram by shape and materiality and color, form this kind of collective ensemble, which I believe has an emergent property. And if not, it's just fun to see. This is the waterfall of chairs. It kind of flows up. So there's a white strain, a black strain, and a color strain. They form a kind of braid at the top. They land and turn into something else. These are Hussein Chalayan dresses. As we were working, I was trying to find all the ways I could get the evolution of that diagram. So this is the Miyake folding into the, this is unfolded, folded, turning into the Frank Stella, turning into the Frank Gehry, Ingo Mara, lamp, to the EV day. This was a diagram we did very early on. Then we tried to see if we could construct this installation in the shot. So there it is now. There's the Stella, the Ingo Mara, the Issey Miyake, and there's the EV day. So you see these connections and flows or evolutions. That's a Tony Craig. So there, so you can see those, that diagram working out. This is the skate bowl and the vortexes of bikes and blades. These are the frame vortexes. Isn't it weird to go through that entire lecture and have somebody just hang a bunch of bicycle frames on a vortex and claims that's emergent behavior from a large number of elements in intricate communication? But that's what curators do. That's the boards. Go upstairs and you watch these incredible people skate the skateboard. It's unbelievable what they do. They find it incredibly blissful. I find it incredibly frightening and intoxicating. And then you go outside and you see, this is one of the wind turbine blades that you see in Southern California sitting outside or just about to be installed outside the front door of this show. Thanks. Any questions?
Yeah.
I think that's a really great question. Anyone else have a question? If the principle of emergent behavior is correct, I mean, if the principle of complex adaptive networks, which basically argues that anytime you can mobilize its parts and put them in a communication, you will get emergent behavior, then the internet and all the forms of telecommunication are absolutely doing that. A large number of parts, unprecedented number of parts are being mobilized and put into communication. The incredible thing about emergent behavior is you don't know it. The birds don't know, as individuals, that they're producing emergent behavior. You have to stand outside of it, like we were, watch it, and see its emergent behavior. And I don't know where you stand to see it. But I do know one thing, it must be happening, and it must be radically revising all of the flows that constitute social life, economic, social, constructions of typologies, material behavior. I know it's a disappointing answer, but I tell you what, it's a better answer than anyone who's claiming that they are able to analytically predict and produce the emergent behaviors from the connectivity. It's also much more interesting. It's a little bit like this. No cell in your body knows it's in your body. Not one, you know, and it gets along fine thinking it's doing what it's doing, hence there's you. Now, a very few of them can produce me talking and claim it knows me. In fact, there's one of the great things about the brain is how much it admires itself. It's always sort of claiming it's the most important organ, which I find really incredible because it runs your mouth, you know, and I pretty much know it's not the most important organ, but I can't manage to say something. So I don't know. The whole thing is, once you start thinking about these problems and you think about what cells do what and what they claim, and I do think it's really interesting that the brain admires itself so much but hates the way it looks. Now that's the best I can do to answer your question. Any other questions? Okay. Oh, but you ask one every year. Thank you so much. You get two questions.
I also think the idea of some emergent behavior can be grounded depending on the psychology.
Yeah, I mean, are you saying that the emergent effects of a Jackson Pollock painting have to do with the fact that he basically used intuitively the principles of a large number of parts communicating with one another? And that, in fact, not only does it happen within a painting, but it happens when you see a show between paintings. And I would say that's true except when Jackson Pollock starts to decorate his paintings. So in stuff like Blue Poles, I mean, there's times when Jackson Pollock, I think, was, I know you're not asking about this, I don't think he was a strong painter, and I don't think most of his work is good. I think he was a very weak painter with very little self-confidence that almost every painting shows who he had lunch with that day. And very often it's, you know, somebody who was also a good artist. But occasionally there are incredible paintings that show amazing courage, and they do what you're saying. So, I mean, this also has to do with my personal reflection on the overestimation of Jackson Pollock and the underappreciation of how bad some of his paintings are, but also how great some of them are. But of course, I mean, it's material being mobilized to produce information. And anytime you move matter, you will produce emergent information. Now, more important for me, and I was hoping that would come out tonight, is it's really important. I mean, I tried to show, for example, political ideas and philosophical ideas in movies, in painting, in sculpture, and in architecture, to disabuse you of the notion that it's the idea that's important, to raise the idea that each practice contributes in a fundamental and irreducible way, so that there's no such thing as an idea which transcends that. And in some sense, every practice has to find its moment with an idea for an idea to be what it is. And so it's as important for me, if we're going to talk about Jackson Pollock, to say, yes, it's true, but it's not unique or specific or privileged by Jackson Pollock. I think, for example, well, I'll answer another question, but I'll use the next question to continue this answer. Yes?
I'm wondering if you could talk about the river, the Western relationship to the Akkadian show.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, when I got psychoanalyzed by Herbert Mouchamp in the New York Times for Moodbearer and discovered things about myself I never imagined to be true, but was delighted to learn, I got home that night, and on my phone there was a message from Dave Hickey. Said that that was the single best review he'd ever read in the New York Times. I have a lot of problems with the answer to the question is that there's a deep affinity between the two, you know, and I think I think Dave Hickey and I are moving towards different directions. In a certain sense, I think David has embraced a notion of the failure of intellection. What I believe is that there's a status of intellection, that a deeper intellection, which leads in some sense to oftentimes the same conclusion, that an intellectual life can become critical of an institutionalized version of an intellectual life and come to conclusions that are similar. You know, so I think there's a kind of reactionary quality to David's thinking and writing in general that I'm suspicious of. Although the production of that show in the New Cosmopolitanism, it was so close in its sensibility and its production of effects. You know, I think the thing that I thought we did in Mood River is showed a connection between two species of material practice, art and design. Of course, design has many subspecies, without dissolving those two species into a single idea. I mean, I don't think art and designer are the same, and I think the way they produce effects are radically different, and I don't think Dave did that in his show, but he did. So his show is much more about the different way an artistic practices construct that behavior. But it was fantastic. Did you see it? Yes. All right. Yeah, I mean, the answer to that is absolutely. I mean, essentially, the problem of the Baroque became the problem of taking control over the technique of production of experience. And what they discovered very early on was this problem of mobilizing a lot of problems. And, you know, they basically discovered very early that technique produced affect through a kind of rudimentary version of the principles of emergence. What they were also governed, however, by an allegiance to transcendentality. And so it's highly shaped by representational effects. The fantastic idea of an abstract Baroque, which is in part what we're looking at today, such that we have to understand that would not be any neo thing. It would belong to today. I mean, I think that's true. I mean, basically, if you realize, for example, that those birds are producing affect without representation, and therefore the organization is adequate in and of itself, and you think through the problem of the Baroque again, it would be fantastic. And I think that's, in some sense, what's going on. Although, we don't have anywhere near the detail of their technique. Their levels of fineness in communication, because of the materials that they were working with and the technique they had to use them, it's not lost knowledge, but it's abandoned knowledge. You know, we couldn't afford to do it. I mean, it wouldn't be, it's not a claim that we should go back to that. But we would have to find some way to mobilize the economic forces in concert with the material forces to do that. But the answer to that, the short answer is absolutely. I got to quit. I just got the don't talk anymore sign. Thank you very much.